now? Have no idea why, but that's not a good sign, is it? Okay, usually when the blue lights come on and then they go off, that's the end of the show. One of the things really well. Either side of the spillway, you'll notice powerhouses. They are 2 city blocks long. The windows, when they were lit up, 17 feet wide, 40 feet tall. So as you can see, everything is big. Now, to give you an idea of what it is you're looking at, you're about 3/4 of a mile away. The characters you will see, towards the beginning of the show, you have the earthquakes, the volcanoes, and the forming of the world, and then you have the animals along the river, and then you're going to have a Native American. He is 150 feet wide, he is 200 feet tall. He's in full headdress. You will see a canoe that will leave from across the river at the Wright Powerhouse, and that canoe is 100 feet long. Right after the canoe, you'll see another Native American in full headdress. He too is 150 by 200. Approximately in the middle of the show, you're going to see an aircraft carrier. It is 1/3 the actual size. There will be a World War II airplane that will come out and bomb the carrier. It is the actual size of a World War II airplane. Towards the end of the show, with Neil Diamond Sr., you're going to see an eagle. He will come out and he'll make some turns and swoops and dives. And unlike most fishermen, he will catch a big fish. He will measure from wingtip to wingtip at one point as he turns on the spillway 300 feet. Give you an idea. For those of you with 35 millimeter cameras, Pentax, with that medium-sized lens on it, you are 3/4 of a mile away. Good luck if you think you can get a picture. At the beginning of the show, you noticed there were some blue lights that were on down there as part of the bank light system. We used those from 1958 until 1988. Then we came with the laser show. We've used the same laser show since 1989. If you see, can't sit back and enjoy the show.
I'm gonna go get some more. fed the lifeblood of many creatures and felt their touch through time. They have drunk of my bounty and prospered at my side. Some were tool users, a people whose skills were unique among any creatures I had ever seen. Many different tribes of these people grew to live along my banks, yet all spoke variations of only four spoken tongues. And in my memory still live the ancestors of those people known as the Salish, the Sahaptin, the Chinook, and the Kootenai. These were the first men and women to battle the elements and live their lives by my side. All had a different name for me, but their meanings were the same. With greatest respect, they named me the Big River. Time, as many poets have penned, must indeed flow onward, and so it came to be that I was named again. Nearly 200 years ago, a bold Captain Robert Gray became the first white man to enter the fierce tidal waters where I confront the Pacific. Seeking to conquer me, he challenged my might and sailed slowly upstream. But in the end, it was he who was conquered. He sailed away, but he left behind a legacy. He named me after the sturdy ship which made his journey possible. And that name, Columbia, has been with me from that day. When a daring team of explorers, blazing their way across the nation, encountered thundering rapids. These two men were searching for a route across America. I, over the course of eons, had carved mine through the bedrock of the country. It was inevitable that our paths should cross. Upon their return east, Lewis and Clark told their story to countrymen, who listened with excitement and yearning to descriptions of the vast, fertile lands to the west and the mighty Columbia River. Thank you. settlers flock west to the promise and power of my homelands. They found the volcanic soil from my ancient past to be an excellent topsoil. Farming began, and the crops were fruitful and productive. For a time, in a number of quick years, their yields diminished rapidly as they exhausted what moisture was in the soil. A number of years of above-average rainfall had misled them all. Their crops were doomed to fail. It became painfully apparent that unless a means could be found to halt the erosion of the topsoil, this whole expanse of potentially fertile land would soon be consigned to desert. The hundreds of thousands of acres cleared for farming began instead to blow away. A small group of dedicated people devised a plan to construct a dam. Having lived amidst this changing land and sharing in the sorrow and concern, they sought to distribute my life-giving waters across a million acres of thirsty land. Eventually led to a full-scale government study of the Columbia Basin. This report not only favored the dam, but went further, recommending 8 dams to completely harness the potential of my swirling waters. The largest dam of them all being the key for control of my entire path, the Grand Coulee Dam. To the President of the United States, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, this project represented not a costly expenditure, but a valuable investment for the nation. An investment that would not only be capable of paying for itself many times over, but would strengthen this country by strengthening its resources. In the time following the Great Depression, allocating such massive funding was a bold move. But FDR convinced Congress and made the project part of his Public Works Administration project, supplying jobs to the nation's unemployed and helping to put the nation back to work. When the ground was broken on July 16, 1933, it signaled a start to a flow of workers that would soon transform a population of less than 25 to more than 16,000, with over 7,000 men and women working on the dam. In my thousands of centuries of existence, never have I witnessed a more ambitious task. 22 million cubic yards of dirt and rock had to be removed. Miles of holes were drilled into the bedrock to test for fissures. Tons of concrete were pumped into the fissures under 600 pounds of pressure, readying the bedrock for 12 million cubic yards of concrete. A refrigeration plant had to be installed in order to freeze an entire cliff face and put an end to its landslides. My natural course had to be diverted, and the granite riverbed beneath hand-polished in order to prepare it for the massive amount of concrete to follow. One block at a time, concrete was poured, and the dam began to grow. Soon, my waters were backing up behind the dam. As a new lake began to form, surveyors marked out a line 1,290 feet above sea level. Everything below would be submerged in my icy chill. Now, rising in stark contrast to the grand scope and vision of the project's benefits, came the hard realities of the trade-offs for such aspiring dreams. 11 towns were abandoned or moved. A once thriving salmon run was reduced, and many Native American tribal fishing sites disappeared. American Indians gathered for a ceremony of tears when their tribal fishing grounds at Kettle Falls was overrun. Measures were taken to make up for the loss. Salmon runs were transplanted to downriver tributaries. Fish ladders and lifts were installed where possible. And hatcheries were created to stock newly formed message was clear. No change in the land could be without a change in the lives of those who inhabited the land, both man and animal. Painful were these trade-offs, but the benefits of this single project soon were to serve the entire country. 8 years after it was begun, the largest concrete structure in the world backed water nearly 150 miles to the Canadian border. The Grand Coulee Dam had been completed. Very soon afterwards, Chief Jim James of the Sam Boyle Band pushed a button delivering the first hydroelectric energy from the dam to the Colville Confederated Tribes Reservation. I was now the driving force behind the largest hydroelectric plant in the world. Electricity, hydroelectricity, non-polluting, inexpensive production of electric power from water. It may sound like a difficult concept for a river, but I understand all that involves me. Allow me to explain. The process begins with water and the certainty that it will always flow downhill. Water flowing toward its distant destination is drained down an inlet tube called a penstock and into a turbine. The great force of water rushing into this confined space pushes against blades, which in turn rotate a shaft and a powerful electromagnet called a rotor. This rapidly moving rotor spins within a stationary ring of copper, thereby causing the electrons in the copper to flow, creating electricity. The water is then discharged, and it continues along its peaceful path to the ocean. Tanks. This incredible need for increased war industry brought with it in turn a need for incredible amounts of electricity. Electric welding alone could speed up much production, and in shipbuilding could cut production time from 200 days to a mere 20. But the greatest consumer of electricity involved the production of the vast quantities of aluminum needed. In all, inexpensive hydroelectricity in the Pacific Northwest attracted wartime industries representing over $1 billion. A region that had no aluminum production at all soon produced 40% of all U.S. aluminum. With just a small fraction of my potential energy being harnessed, enough energy was now being produced to meet this demand, making the Columbia Basin project a significant help not only to the Pacific Northwest economy, but to the United States and the end of World War II. But the benefit that was the driving force behind this project has transformed a virtual desert into one of the world's most productive agricultural areas. Less than 3% of my waters are diverted, and yet this water provides nearly 2,000 farms with a life-giving moisture to produce over $300 million worth of crops annually. Continues to provide water and life year after year. Only 50% complete, it has the potential to irrigate all of its 1.1 million acres by the mid-21st century. Grand Coulee Dam is the keystone of this project, generating more power than any hydroelectric dam in the U.S., and with a pumping capacity of 1 billion gallons of water per day. States, am the mightiest, with the steepest drop per mile of any American river. And though my course is no longer wild and untamed, my strength is as great as ever. Through the harnessing of my power and the power of many other rivers, the United States remains a world leader in water resource development. FDR once sent this message to Congress. Man and nature must work hand in hand. Think of our land and water and human resources as life-giving assets to be administered by wise provision for future days. At a visit to the construction of Grand Coulee Dam, he concluded, I leave here today with the feeling that this work is well undertaken, that we are going ahead with a
Thank you.
this concludes our show. Hope that you've enjoyed it. And we'll see you the next time you're here. Thank you.
I haven't read enough to figure out how to set it for low light levels yet.